his turn. And our cast includes Alejandro Arango, Joe Bartkovich, Alyse Clinton, Charis Edwards, Raul Galvan, Billy O'Hanley, Hebe Hilhorst, Quinn Hickey, Tyler Ho, Ian Johnson, Nick Madamidola, George Mattheos, Annie Ning, Eliran Oz, Nolan Peacock, Miguel Perez, and Taylor Robertson. And we have Daisy Tichenor and Nada Zohayr as our producers and stage managers. There will be a short 10-minute intermission. Bathrooms are out there, emergency exit is there and there. Please turn off your cell phones and enjoy the show.
Assisted by that most disloyal traitor, the Thane of Cawdor, began a dismal conflict. Till that Bellona's bridegroom, lapped in proof, confronted him with self-comparisons, point against point, rebellious arm against arm, curbing his lavish spirit. And to conclude, the victory fell on us.
No more that Thane of Cawdor shall deceive our bosom in death. Go! Pronounce his present death! And with his former title, Queen Macbeth.
I'll see it's done.
What he hath lost, noble Macbeth, hath won.
Oh. give me to thine. Arise thee, witch! The rough-fed Runyon cries her husbands to a lego god, master of the tide. In a seethe all in her sail, and like a rat without a tail, I'll do, and I'll do, and I'll do.
I'll get thee away!
Thark kind!
And I another!
And I myself have all the other in the very ports they blow, all the quarters that they know in the shipment's cart. I'll drain him dry as hay. Sleep shall neither night nor day hang upon his penthouse lid. He shall live, a man forbid. Weary 7 nights, 9 times 9, shall he fortune peak and pine. Though his bark cannot be lost, yet it shall be tempest tossed. Look what I have.
Help me!
Here I have a pilot's thumb, wrapped as homeward he did come.
A drum, Macbeth.com!
So foul and fair a day I have not seen.
I thought it was a cult of glory. What are these? So willing and so wild in their tide, they look now like the inhabitants of the earth and yet are not.
Speak, if you can. What are you?
Hail, Macbeth! Thane of Galahs!
Hail, Macbeth! Thane of Cawdor! All hail, Macbeth, that shall be king hereafter!
Sir, why do you start and seem to fear things that do sound so fair? In the name of truth, are ye fantastical? Or that indeed whichever you shall? My noble party, you greet with present grace and great prediction of royal happiness of the hopes. They seem wrapped with awe. To me, you speak not. If you can look at the sands of time and say which grace will grow and which will not, speak then to me, who begs nor fears your favor nor your hate.
Lesser than Macbeth, and greater.
Not as happy, and yet! Thou shalt get kings, though thou be none. So all hail Macbeth and Banquo.
Banquo and Macbeth, all hail.
Stay, you imperfect speakers. Tell me more. By civil death I know that I am Thane of Glamis, but how of Cawdor? The Thane of Cawdor lives. Kind and prosperous gentleman, and to be king stands not within the prospect of belief, no more than to be Cawdor. Say from whence you owe this strange intelligence, or why upon this blasted heap you stop our way with such prophetic reading. Speak! I charge you!
The earth hath bones of the water has, and these are all them. Whither have they vanished?
Into the air, and what seemed corporal melted as breath in the wind. Would they have stayed?
Were such things here as you speak of? Or have we done the insane that takes the reason prisoner?
Your children shall be kings.
You shall be king.
And Thane of Cawdor too, went it not so?
It's the self same tune of words. Who's that?
The king hath happily received, Macbeth, the news of thy success, and when he leads thy personal venture in the rebel's fight, his wonders and his praises do contend which should be thine or his. As thick as tail came post with post, and every one did bear thy praises in his kingdom's great defense and poured them down before him.
We are sent to give thee from our royal master's thanks, only to herald thee into his sight, not pay thee.
And, for an earnest of a greater honor, he bade me, from him, call thee Thane of Cawdor. In which addition, hail, most worthy Thane, for it is thine.
Why can the devil speak true?
The Thane of Cawdor lives. Why do you dress me in borrowed robes?
Who was the Thane lives yet? But under heavy judgment bears that life which he deserves to lose. Whether he was combined with those of Norway, did line the rebel with hidden help and vantage. Well, that with boats he labored in this country's brack, I know not. But treasons, capital, confessed, and proved, have overthrown him.
Longs and Thane of Cawdor, the greatest is behind. I thank you, gentlemen. Do you not hope your children shall be kings, when those that gave the Thane of Cawdor to me promise no less to them?
Bad trust in home, my yen and kill me over the throne, besides the Thane of Cawdor. But 'tis strange, and oftentimes to win us to our arms, the instruments of darkness tell us truths, win us with honest trifles, to betray us in deepest consequence. Cousins, a word, I pray.
Thanks for your pains. This supernatural soliciting cannot be good, cannot be ill. If ill, why hath it given me earnest of success commencing in a truth? I am Thane of Cawdor. If good, why do I yield to that horrid image which makes my seated heart knock at my ribs? Present fears are less than horrible imaginings. My thought, whose murder yet is but fantastical, shakes so my single state of man is smothered in surmise, and nothing is but what is not.
The car part is wrath.
If chance will have me king, why, chance may crown me without my stir.
You want us, come upon them, and like our strange garments, cleave not to their mold with the abuse.
Come what come may, time and the hour run through the roughest day.
What of the Macbeth we stay upon your leisure?
I do forget. My dull brain was wroth with things forgot. Kind gentlemen, your pains are registered when every day I turn the leaf to read them. Let us toward the king. Think upon what hath chanced, and add more time, the interim having waited, let us speak our free hearts to each other.
Very gladly.
Till then, enough. Come, friends!
In the face. He was a noble gentleman on whom I put my absolute trust. Oh, worthiest cousin, the sin of my ingratitude even now is heavy on thee. Thou art so far before that swiftest wing of recompense is slow to overtake thee. Well, thou hast it less deserved, that the proportion both of thanks and payment might have been mine. Only I have left to say, more as I do, the more all can pay.
Service and the loyalty I owe in doing it pays itself. Your Highness's part is to receive our duties, and our duties are to your throne and state, children and servants, which do but what they should by doing everything they can towards your love and honor.
Welcome hither. I have begun to plant thee, and will labor to make thee full of growth. Noble Banquo, that hast no less deserved, nor must be known, no less to have done so. Let me enfold thee, and hold thee close to my heart.
There, if I grow the harvest your own.
My plenteous joys, wanton in fullness, seek to hide themselves in jobs of sorrow. Sons, kinsmen, thanes, and you whose places are the nearest, know we will establish our state upon our eldest. Malcolm! The Prince of Cumberland, which honor must not unaccompanied and best lonely, but signs of nobleness like stars shall shine on all deservers. From hence to Enverness, and bind us further to you.
The rest is labor which is not used for you. I'll be myself the harbinger, and make joyful the hearing of my wife with your approach. So humbly take my leave.
My worthy colleague.
The Prince of Cumberland! That is a step upon which I must fall, or else o'erleap. for in my way it lies. Stars, hide your fires. Let not light see my black and deep desires. The eye winketh the hand. Let that be that which the eye fears when it is done to see.
They met me in the day of success, and I have learned by the perfectest report that they have more in them than mortal knowledge. When I burned and desired to question them further, they made themselves air, into which they vanished. Was I so wrapped in the wonder that came missive from the king, who all hailed me, Thane of Cawdor? By which title, before, these weird sisters saluted me and referred me to the coming on of time with Hail, King. That shall be. This have I thought good to deliver thee, my dearest partner of greatness, that thou mightst not lose the dues of rejoicing by being ignorant of what greatness has promised thee. Lay it to thy heart, and farewell.
Glamis thou art, and Cawdor, and shalt be what thou art promised. And I do fear thy nature. It is too full of the milk of human kindness to catch the merest ray. Thou wouldst be great, art not without ambition, without the illness should attend it. But thou wouldst highly that wouldst thou holily, wishest not play false, and yet wouldst wrongly win. Thou dost have it. Break longs, that which cries, thus thou must do, and that which rather thou dost fear to do than wishes should be undone. Hie thee hither, that I may pour my spirits in thine ear and chastise with the valor of my tongue all that impedes thee from the golden round which fate and metaphysical aid doth seem to have thee crowned with all. What is your tidings?
The king comes here tonight.
Thou art mad to say it is not thy master with him who word so would implore for preparation.
So please you, it is true, our Thane is coming. One of my fellows hath speed of him, who, almost dead for breath, had scarcely more than would make the message.
Give him tending, he brings great news. The raven himself is hoarse, that croaks the fatal entrance of Duncan under my battlements. Come, you spirits that tend on mortal thoughts, unsex me here. And fill me from the crown to the toe, top full of direst cruelty. Make thick my blood, and stop up the access and passage to remorse, that no compunctious visitings of nature shake my fell purpose, nor keep peace between the deed and it. Come to my woman's breast and take my milk for gall. You murdering ministers, wherever in your sightless substances you wait on nature's mischief. Come, thick night and pall in the dunnest smoke of hell, that my keen knife see not the wound it makes, nor heaven peer through the blanket of the dark to cry hold, hold. Great Glamis, worthy Cawdor, greater than both by the all hail hereafter. Thy letters have transported me beyond the ignorant present, and I feel now the future in the instant.
My dearest love, Duncan, comes here tonight.
And when goes hence?
Tomorrow, as he purposes.
Oh, never shall sun that morrow see. Your face, my Thane, is a book. where men may read strange matters. To beguile the time, look like the time. Bear welcome in your eye, your hand, your tongue. Look like the innocent flower, but be the serpent under it. He that is coming must be provided for, and you shall leave this night's great business to my dispatch, which shall, to all our nights and days to come, give solely sovereign sway and masterdom.
We will speak further.
Only look up clear. To alter favor ever is to fear. Leave all the rest to me.
Success! Ah, that this blow might be the be-all and end-all here. But here, on this bank and shoal of time, we jump to the life to come. But in these cases, we still have judgment here, that we but teach bloody instructions, which being taught return to plague the inventor. This even-handed justice commends the ingredients of our poison chalice to our own lips. He's here in double trust. First, as I am his kinsman and his subject, strong both against the deed. Then, as his host, who should against his murderer shut the door, not bear the knife myself. Besides, this Duncan hath borne his faculties so meek, hath been so clear in his great office that his virtues will plead like angels, trumpet-tongued against the deep damnation of his taking off, and pity like a naked newborn babe striding the blast, or heaven's cherubim, forced upon the sightless couriers of the air, shall blow the horrid deed in every eye, the tears shall drown the wind. I have no spur to prick the sides of my intent, but only vaulting ambition, which o'erleaps itself and falls upon the other. What news?
He hath almost supped. Why have you left the chamber?
Hath he asked for me?
Know you not he has.
We will proceed no further in this business. He hath honored me of late, and I have bought golden opinions from all sorts of people, which would be worn now in their newest gloss, not cast aside so soon.
Was the hope drunk wherein you dressed yourself? And hath it slept since? And wakes it now to look so green and pale, and what it did so freely? From this time, such I account thy love. Art thou afeard to be the same in thine own act and valor as thou art in desire? Wouldst thou have that which thou esteemest the ornament of life, only to live a coward in thine own esteem, lacking, I dare not, wait upon, I would, like the poor cat in the attic?
Pretty peace! I dare do all that may become a man, who dares do more is none.
What beast was it then that made you break this enterprise to me? when you just do it, then you are a man. And to be more than what you were, you would be so much more than man. Nor time nor place did then adhere, yet you would make them both. They do make themselves, and that their fitness does unmake you. I have given suck, and know how tender 'tis to love the babe that milks me. I would, while it was smiling in my face, have plucked my nipple from its boneless gums and dashed the brains out, had I so sworn as you have to this.
If we should fail.
We fail. But screw your courage to the sticking place, and will not fail. While Duncan is asleep, where to the rather shall the day's hard journey soundly invite him? His chamberlains will I, with wine and wassail, so convince that memory, the warder of the brain, shall be a fume, and receipt of reason a limbeck only. While in swinish sleep their drenched natures lies in a death, what cannot you and I perform upon the unguarded Duncan? What not put upon his spongy officers who shall bear the guilt of our great quell?
Bring forth men, children only, for thy undaunted metal should compose nothing but males. Will it not be received when we have marked with blood those sleepy two of his own chamber and used their very daggers? But they have done it.
Who dares receive it other when we shall make our griefs and clamors roar upon his death?
I am settled. And bend up each corporal agent to this terrible feat. Away, and mock the time with fairest show. False face must hide what false heart doth know.
Way to repose. Who's that?
A friend.
What, sir, not yet rest? The king's abed. He hath been in most unusual pleasure, and sent forth great largesse to your offices. This diamond he greets your wife withal, by the name of most kind hostess, and shut up and measure his consent. I dreamt last night of the three weird sisters. To you they have showed some truth?
I think not of them. Yet, when we can entreat an hour to serve, we would spend it in some words upon this business, if you would grant the time.
At your kindest leisure.
If you shall cleave to my consent, it shall make honor for you.
So I lose none in seeking to augment it, but to keep my bosom franchised and my allegiance clear, I shall be counseled.
We propose the while.
Thanks, sir, the like to you.
Toward my hand. Come, let me clutch thee. I have thee not, yet I see thee still. Art thou not, fatal vision, sensible to feeling as to sight? art thou the dagger of the mind, a false creation proceeding from the heat-oppressed brain? I see thee yet, form as palpable as this which now I draw. Now marshalest me the way that I was going, and such an instrument I was to use. Mine eyes are made fools of the other senses, or else worth all the rest. I see thee still, and on thy blade and dungeon gouts of blood, which was not so before. There's no such thing! It is the bloody business which informs thus to mine eyes. Now o'er the one half world nature seems dead, and wicked dreams abuse the curtain sleep. Witchcraft celebrates pale Hecate's offerings, and withered murder, alarmed by his sentinel, the wolf whose howls his watch, thus with stealthy pace, with Tarkin's ravishing strides towards his design moves like a ghost. Thou sure and firm set earth, hear not my steps, which way they walk, for fear thy very stones pricked of my whereabouts and take the present horror from the time, which now suits with it. Was I threat, he lives. Words to the heat of deeds too cold breath gives. I go, and it is done. Invite me. Hear it not, Duncan, for it is a knell that summons thee to heaven, or to hell.
Charged with snorers, I have drugged their possets. That death and nature do contend about them whether they live or die.
Who's there? What ho?
Alack, I'm afraid they've awaited, tis not done. The attempt and not the deed confounds us. I laid the daggers ready, he could not miss them. Had he not resembled my father as he slept, I had done it. My husband.
I have done the deed. Didst thou not hear a noise?
I heard the owl scream and the crickets cry. Didst not thou speak?
When?
Now!
Has I descended?
I!
Hark! Who lies in the second chamber?
Donald Bain.
This is a sorry sight.
A foolish thought to say a sorry sight.
As one did laugh in sleep, and one cried murder, that they did wake each other. I stood and heard them. But they did say their prayers, and address them again to sleep.
They are two lodged together.
One cried, God bless us, and amen. The other, as they had seen me with these hangman's hands, listening their fear. I could not say amen when they did say God bless us.
Consider it not so deeply.
But wherefore could I not pronounce amen? I was in most need of blessing, and amen stuck in my throat.
These things must not be thought on after these ways. They will make us mad.
Methought I heard a voice cry, sleep no more. Macbeth doth murder sleep. Oh, the innocent sleep, sleep that knits up the raveled sleeve of care, death of each day's life, balm of hurt minds, sore labor's bath, great nature's second course, chief nourisher in life's feast.
What do you mean?
Still it cried, slave no more to all the house. Glamis hath murdered sleep, and therefore Cawdor shall sleep no more. Macbeth shall sleep no more.
Who was it that thus cried, my worthy thane, to untend your noble strength, but think so great sickly of things? Go, get a little water, and wash this filthy witness from your hands. Why have you brought the daggers from the place they must lie there? Go, carry them, and smear the sleepy grooms with blood.
I am afraid to think on what I have done. Look on again, I dare not.
Firm of purpose, give me the daggers. The sleeping and the dead are but as pictures to the eye of childhood that fears a painted devil. If he do bleed, I'll gild the faces of the grooms with all, for it must seem their guilt.
What is that knocking? Oh, why is it me that every noise appalls me? What hands are here? They pluck out mine eyes. Will all great Neptune's ocean wash the blood clean from my hand? No, this my hand would rather the multitudinous seas incarnate, making the green one red.
My hands are of your color, but I shame to wear a heart so white. There's a knocking at the south entry. Retire we to our chamber. A little water clears us of this deed. How easy it is, then, your constantly have left me unattended. Hark, more knocking. Get on your nightgown. Let's occasion call us and show us to be watchers. Be not lost so poorly in your thoughts.
To hope I to eat, twere best not know myself. Wake Duncan with thy knocking. Oh, would that thou couldst.
Here's a knocking indeed.
You a man or porter of Helgen?
You should have all been turning the key.
Knock, knock, knock. Who's there in the name of Yelp?
There's a farmer who hanged himself on the expectation of plenty. Got a little time.
I have napkins enough about you.
Here, let's go for it.
Knock, 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 who's there in the other bed?
Here's an equivocator.
Who can swear in both the scales against either scale? Who can make treason?
Enough for God's sake.
Not equivocating to heaven.
I come in, equivocator.
Knock, knock, knock! Who's there?
Oh, here's an English tailor. Another for stealing out of a French hose.
Oh.
Come in, tailor. Here you may roast your goose.
Knock, knock, knock! Never quite! What are you?
This place is too cold for hell.
Oh, devil portrait, no further. I thought to let in some of all professions to go the primrose way to the everlasting bonfire. Add it on, add it on!
I pray you, remember the porter.
Was it so late, friend? There you went to bed. That you do lie so late?
Aye, sir. We were carousing in the second hall. And drinker is a great provoker.
And what three things does drink especially provoke?
Mary, sir. Nose painting. Sleep.
And drink.
Lecturing, sir! It provokes it, unprovokes it. Provokes the desire, but takes away the performance. Therefore, much drink may be said to be unequivocated with lecture. <Ha! laughs> It makes him and it mars.
It sets him off.
Sets him off. Ha! It persuades him and disheartens him.
Makes him stand too.
And that's what he
giving him the lie leaves him.
Ah, I do believe the drink gave you the lie last night.
Aye, sir, in the very throat of me. I requited him for his lie.
Well, he took up on my legs.
Yet I made a shift to cast him.
Ah. Is that Master Stir? God luck you with him. Here he comes.
Good morrow, noble sir.
Good morrow, both.
Is he stirring everything?
Not yet.
Did you command me to call time, Leon? It's almost with the hour.
I'll bring you to him.
You know, this is a joyful trip. Yet tis one.
The labor we delight in, physics pain. There is the door.
I'll make so bold to call. This is my limited service.
Goes the king hence today?
He does. He to the point so.
The night has been unruly. Where we lay our chimneys were blown down. And it is said, lamentings heard on the air, strange sounds of death, and prophesying in accents terrible, of dire combustion and confused events, new hatched to the woeful time. The obscure bird did clamor the livelong night. Some say the earth was feverous and did shake.
'Twas a rough night.
My young remembrance cannot parallel.
Horror! 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 Time to hawk! Could I conceive nor name thee?
What's the matter?
Now the confusion hath made his masterpiece. More sacrilegious murder! Hath broke open the Lord's anointed temple and stolen hence the life of the building!
What is it you say? The life? Mean you his majesty?
Approach his chamber, the destroyer's sight within him, Gordon. Not let me speak! See and speak yourselves! Away! Away! Ring the alarum bell! Murder and treason! Bankworm and Madamidola being awake! Shake off this dowdy sleep, death's counterfeit, and look on death itself! Up! Up into the great tomb's image! Magum! Bankworm! Oh, as if from your graves rise up and walk like sprites and countenance this horror! Oh, ring the bell!
What's the business of those horrible trumpet calls departing the sleepers of the house? Speak, speak!
Gentle lady, so free to hear what I can speak. Repetition in a whimsy of commercial as hell. Bankworm! Bankworm! Oh, the real master is in my judgment.
Woe, alas, in our house!
Too cruel anyway. Dear Duff, I prithee, contradict thyself and say is not so.
That I had died an hour before this chance, I had lived a blessed time. For now there is nothing serious in mortality. Renown and grace is dead. All is but toys. The wine of life is drawn, and the mere lees is left this vault to brag of.
What is amiss?
You are, and do not know it. The spring, the head, the fountain of your blood is stopped. The very source of it stopped.
Before the father's mercy.
Oh, my home!
Those of his chamber, so it seemed, have done it. Their hands and faces go mad to the blood, and where their daggers, which we found unsheathed upon their faces, grew distracted. No man's life was to be trusted with them.
Oh, yet I do repent me of my fury, that I did kill them.
Wherefore did you so?
Who can be wise, amazed, temperate and furious, loyal and neutral in a moment? No, man. The expedition of my violent love outrun the paws of reason. Here lay Duncan, his silver skin laced with blood and blood, and his gash stabs looked like a breach in nature for ruin's wasteful entrance. Here, the murderers, steeped in the colors of their trade, their daggers unmannerly breached with gore. Who could refrain that had a heart to love and courage to make his love known?
Help me! Help me!
Why do we hold our tongue that both may claim this argument for ours?
What should be spoken here were our fate hidden in Arbor home in Russian seasons? Let away our tears and not brood,
nor strong sorrow upon the fun of motion.
We have our naked frailties here that suffer exposure. Let us meet and discuss this most bloody piece of work to no further. Fear and scruple shake us. In the great hand of God, I stand against the undivulged pretense of treasonous malice.
As do I.
So all. Briefly put on manly readiness and meet in the hall together.
What will you do? Oh, let's not control with them. Be sure not both sorrows and others which a false stand is easy. All to England.
To Ireland, our separated fortune shall keep us both the safer. For we are the daggers and the smiles, the nearer blood, the nearer bludgeon.
This murderous shaft, the shot, hath not yet slain, and our safety wisdom for the aim. Therefore, to horse, and let us not be dainty of relief to eat, but shift away. There's murder and the theft that steals them, and there's no mercy left.
Is it known who did this more than bloody deed?
Malcolm and Donovan stolen away and fled. Puts on them suspicion.
Against nature still, thriftless ambition that will raven up thine own life's means. Then 'tis most like the sovereignty will fall upon Macbeth.
Yes, he's already been named and not disconed to be invested.
Will you disconed?
No, cousin, I'll to fight.
Where are Duncan's bones?
They are carried to Cornwall Kill, the sacred guardian of his ancestors' bones.
Well, I'll to fight.
May we see things well done there. Lest our old room sit easier than our new.
It was said it should not be in thy posterity, but that myself should be the root and father of many kings. If there come truth from them, as upon thee, Macbeth, their speeches shine, why, by the verities of thee, may they not be my uncles as well, and send me up in hope. But hush, no more.
Here's our chief guest. Tonight we hold a solemn supper, sir, and I'll request your presence.
Let your highness command upon me, to the which my duties are with the most indissoluble tie forever knit.
Ride you this afternoon?
Aye, my good lord.
Is it far you ride?
As far, my lord, as will fill the time twixt this and supper. Going on my horse the better, I must become a bar of the night for a dark hour or twain.
I wish your horses swift and sure of foot, and so I do commend you to their backs. Farewell. Goes, Mattheos.
Aye, my lord. Our time does call upon.
Farewell. To keep society the sweeter welcome, we shall keep ourselves till supper time alone. Sir, a word with you.
Attend those men our pleasure.
They are, my lord, without the palace gate.
Bring them before us. To be thus is nothing, but to be safely thus. Our fears in Banquo stick deep, and in his royalty of nature reigns that which would be fear. 'Tis much he dares, and to that dauntless temper of his mind he hath a wisdom that doth guide his valor to act in safety. There's none but he whose being I do fear. And under him my genius is rebuked, as it is said Mark Antony's was by Caesar. He chid the sisters when first they put the name of king upon me, and bade them speak to him. Then, prophet-like, they hailed him father to a line of kings. Upon my head they placed a fruitless crown, and put a barren scepter in my grip, thence to be wrenched with an unlineal hand. No son of mine succeeded. If it be so, for Banquo's issue have I filed my mind. For them, the gracious Duncan, have I murdered, put rancors in the vessel of my peace only for them. mine, eternal jewel given to the common enemy of man to make them kings? The seeds of bankrupt kings? Rather than so, come fate into this and champion me to the utterance? Who's there? Now go to the door and stay there till we call. Was it not yesterday we spoke together?
Was, so please your highness.
Well then, now, have you considered of my speeches? Know that it was he, in times past, who held you so under fortune, which you had thought had been our innocent self. This I made good to you in our last meeting, passed in probation with you how you were born and hanged, the instruments, who wrought them, how crossed, and all things else that might to half a soul into a nation craze, say thus did Banquo.
True, my lord.
I did so, and went further, which is now our point of second inquiry. Do you find your patience so predominant in nature that you can let this go? Are you so gospel to pray for this good man and for his issue, whose heavy hand hath bound you to the grave and beggared yours forever?
We are men, my lord.
Both of you know a Banquo was your enemy.
True.
True, my lord.
So is he mine, and in such bloody distance that every minute of his being flashed against my nearest of life. And though I could, with barefaced power, sweep him from my sight and bid my will avouch it, yet I must not. For certain friends who are both his and mine, whose loves I may not drop, yet weigh of his fall, whom I myself struck down. And thence it is that I to your assistance do make love, masking the business from the common eye for sundry waiting reasons.
We shall, my lord, perform what you command us.
Nor lives.
Your spirits shine through you! Within this hour at most, I will advise you where to plant yourselves, acquaint you with the perfect spy of the time, the moment. For it must be done tonight. And something from the palace. Always thought that I require a clearness. And goes with him to leave no rubs nor botches in the work. Flails. His son, whose absence is no less material to me than is his father's, must embrace the fate of that dark hour. Resolve yourselves apart. I'll come to you anon.
We are resolved.
Bide with him. Call upon you straight. It is concluded. Banquo, thy soul's flight. If by heaven, must find it out tonight.
Is Banquo gone from court?
I am out of the return again tonight.
Not had all spent when our desire is got without content. It is safer to be that which we destroy than by destruction dwell in doubtful joy. How now, my lord? Why do you keep alone? Osorius fancies your companions making, using those thoughts which should indeed have died. With them they think on? What's done is done. Things without all remedy should be without regard.
We have scorched the snake, not killed it. She'll close and be herself, whilst our poor malice remains in danger of her former tooth. Let the frame of things disjoint. Both the worlds suffer ere we will eat our meal in fear and sleep and the affliction of these terrible dreams that plague us nightly. Better be with the dead, whom we, gain our peace, have sent to peace, than on the torch of the mind to lie in restless ecstasy. Duncan is in his grave. After life's fitful fever, he sleeps well. Treason has done his worst, nor steel nor poison, malice domestic, foreign levy, nothing can touch him further.
Come on, gentle. My lord, sleek o'er your rugged looks, be bright and jovial among your guests tonight.
So shall I, love, and so I pray be you. Let your remembrance apply to Banquo. Present him eminence both with eye and tongue. Unsafe the while that we must lave our honors in these flattering streams and make our faces visits to our hearts, disguising what they are.
You must leave this.
Oh, full of scorpions is my mind. Dear wife, thou knowest that Banquo and Fleance lives.
But in them nature's copy is not a term.
There's comfort yet, they are assailable. From me thou joking, there shall be done a deed of dreadful note.
What's to be done?
Be innocent of the knowledge, dearest Chuck, for thou applaud thee. Come, sealing night, scarf up the tender eye of pitiful day, and with thy bloody and invisible hand cancel and tear to pieces that great bond which keeps me pale. Thou marvelest at my words, but hold me still. Things bad begun make strong themselves by ill. So pretty go with me.
Welcome to feed where best at home from then. the sots to meet were ceremony, meeting were bare without.
Sweet remembrance, sir. Now, good digestion wait on appetite, and health on both.
May it please your highness, sir.
Here had we now our country's honor roofed, were the graced person of our banquo present. May I rather challenge for unkindness than pity for mischance.
His absence, sir, lays blame upon his promise. Please it, your highness, to grace us with your royal presence.
The table's full.
Here's a place reserved.
Where?
Here, my lord. What is it moves you?
Which of you have done this?
Done what, my lord?
Thou canst not say that I did it. Never shake thy gory locks at me.
The gentleman rise. His highness is not well.
Sit, worthy friends. My lord is often thus. It happens in his youth. Pray you, keep seat. The fit is momentary. Upon a thought, he will again be well. If you must know him, you will extend his passion and offend him further. Feed and regard him not. Are you a man?
I am a bold one. Talk of that between a ball of a devil.
Proper stuff. This is the very heat of your fear. This is the air-drawn dagger which you said led you to Duncan. Cry for shame. Why do you make such faces? All is done. You look it on a stool.
Oh, look! Oh, how say you? Why? What care I? If charm passes at our graves, must send those that be buried back. A monument shall be the maws of kites.
Quite unmanned in folly.
If I stand here, I saw him.
Fie for shame.
Blood hath been shed here now. In the olden time, their humane statue purged the gentle weal. Aye, and since too, murders have been performed too terrible for the ear. The time had been that when the brains were out, the man would die, and so an end. But now they rise again, with 20 mortal murders on their crowns to push us from our stools. This is more strange than such a murder is.
My heroic lord, you do not give the cheer. Your noble friends do lack you.
I do forget. Do not muse at me, my most worthy friends. I have a strange infirmity, which is nothing to those that know me. Come, love and health all, and I'll sit down. I drink to the general joy of the whole table. And to our dear friend Banquo, whom we miss. Would he were here. To all, and him we thirst, and all to all.
Our duties and the pledge.
Abort and quit my sight! Let the earth hide me. Thy bones are marrowless, thy blood is cold. There's no speculation in those eyes which thou dost glare with.
Think of this, good peers, but as a thing accustomed to this no other only spoils the pleasure of the time.
One man dare, I dare. Approach thou like the Russian bear, the armed rhinoceros, or the hurricane tiger. Take any shape but that, and my firm nerves will never tremble. Or be alive again, and dare me to the desert with thy spore. If trembling I inhabit then, protest to me the baby of a girl. Hence, horrible shadow! Horrible shadow! Of real mockery! Hence! Why? So being gone, I am a man again. Pray you sit still.
Displace the meeting, broke the mirth with most admired disorder.
Can such things be and overcome us like a summer's cloud without our special wonder? You make me strange even to the disposition that I owe, and now I think you can behold such sights and keep the natural ruby of your cheeks when mine is blanched with fear.
But what sights, my lord?
I pray you, speak not. He grows worse and worse. Question and enrages him. At once, good night. Stand not upon the order of your going, but go at once.
Good night, and better health attend his majesty.
A kind good night to all.
It will have blood, they say. Blood will have blood. Stones have been known to move, and trees to speak. Augurs and understood relations have, by maggot pies and choses and rooks, brought forth the secrets man of blood. What is the night?
Almost at odds with the morning. Which is which?
How sayest thou that Macduff denies his person at our great bidding?
Did you send it, sir?
I hear it by the way. But I will send. There's not a one but in his house. I keep a servant fee. I will tomorrow, and betimes I will, to the Ware assistant. More shall they speak, for now I am bent to know, by the worst means the worst. For my own good, all causes shall give way. I am in blood's toe far that, should I wait it no more, returning were as tedious as go on. Strange things I have in hand, that will to hand, which must be acted ere they may be scanned.
You lack the reason of all nature's sleep.
Come, will to sleep. My strange and self-abusive, the initiate fear, wants hard use. We are yet young, indeed.
Things have been strangely born.
Aye.
The gracious Duncan was pitied of Macbeth. Mary, he was dead. And the right noble Banquo, who walked too late, whom you may say, if it please you, Fleance killed, for Fleance fled. Men must not walk too late. And who cannot help but think how monstrous it was for Malcolm and for Donald Bane to kill their gracious father? Damned fat, how it did grieve Macbeth. Did he not the two delinquents tear that were the slaves of drink and the thralls of sleep? Was this not wisely done? Aye, for it would have angered any heart alive to hear the men deny it. And so I say, he has borne all things well. But I do think that had he Duncan's sons under his key, as and it please heaven, he shall not. They would know what it were to kill a father. So should Fleance. But peace. For because he failed his presence at the tyrant's feast, I hear Macduff lives in disgrace. I pray you, sir, can you tell me where he bestows himself?
Of course. The son of Duncan, from whom this tyrant holds the due of birth, lives in the English court, and is received of the most pious Edward with such grace that the malevolence of fortune nothing takes from his high respect. Thither Macduff has gone to pray the holy king upon his aid, to wake Northumberland and warlike Malcolm, that by the help of these, with him above to ratify the work, we may again give to our tables meat, slake to our knights, free from our feasts and banquets bloody knives, do faithful homage, and receive free honors, all which we pine for now.
Aye.
And this report had so exasperated the king that he prepared for some attempt at war.
Sent he to Macduff?
He did. And with an absolute, sir, not I, the cloudy messenger turns me his back, as if to say, you'll rue the time that clogged you with this answer.
And thou well might advise him to a caution to hold what distance his wisdom can provide. Meanwhile, some holy angel send to the court of England, bringing our message ere he come, that we may have a swift blessing returned to this, our suffering country, under a hand accursed.
I'll send my prayers with him.
Round about the cauldron go, ye
nose of Turk and Tartar's lips, finger of birth strangled babe, ditch delivered by a drab, make the gruel thick and slab, add thereto a tiger's chaudron, pour the ingredients of our cauldron.
Like shadows,
parts! Thou art too like the spirit of Banquo! Down! Thy crown does sear my eyeball! And thy hair, thou other gold-bound brow, is like the first! A third is like the former! Filthy hags! Why do you show me this? A fourth? Starved eyes! What? Will the line stretch out to the crack of doom? Another yet? A seventh? I'll see no more! And yet made the pierce who bears a glass which shows me many more. And some I see that two bolt balls and treble scepters carry. Horrible sight! Well, I see 'tis true, for the blood of Bolter Banquo smiles upon me and points at them for his. Where are they? Gone? Let this pernicious hour stand I accursed in the calendar. Saw you the Weird Sisters?
No, my lord.
Came they not by you?
No, indeed, my lord.
Infected be the air whereon they ride, and damned all those that trust them. But I did hear the galloping of horse. Who was it came by?
Just two or three, my lord, to bring you word. Macduff is fled to England.
Fled? To England?
Aye, my lord.
Time? Thou anticipates who I dread expedient. A flighty purpose never is foretook, unless the deed go with it. From this moment, the very firstlings of my heart shall be the firstlings of my hand. And even now, to crown my thoughts with acts, be it thought and done. The castle of Macduff I will surprise, seize upon Fife, give to the edge of the sword his wife, his babes, and all unfortunate souls that trace him in his line. No more boasting like a fool. This deed I'll do before this purpose cool. But no more sights. Where are these gentlemen? Come, bring me where they are.
Worse with foul cruelty, which is too nigh your person. Heaven preserve you, I dare abide no longer.
Why should I fly? I've done no harm. Oh, but I remember now I am in this earthly world, where to do harm is often laudable, to do good is sometimes accounted dangerous folly. But why, then, I put up that womanly defense to say I've done no harm?
Where's your husband?
And a husband, no place on sight if I present as thou mayst find him!
He's a prince!
Let us see some desolate shade, and there we were sad bosoms empty.
Let us rather hold fast the mortal sword, and like good men, stride our downfallen birthday. Which day, you widows howl, you orphans cry, you sorrows strike heaven on the face, and it resounds as if it felt with scoffing. You'll have that syllable of dolor.
What I believe I'll wail, but no believe that what I can redress, so I shall find the time to friend, I will. It may be so, perchance. This tyrant whose sole name blisters our tongue was once thought honest. You have loved him well. He hath not pushed you yet. I am young, but something you may deserve of him through me and wisdom to offer up a weak, poor, innocent lamb to appease an angry god.
I am not treacherous!
But Macbeth is! A good and virtuous nature may recoil in an imperial charge.
I have lost my hopes.
Perchance even there where I did find my doubts. Why in that rawness left you, wife and child, those precious motives, those strong knots of love without leave-taking?
Flee! Flee! Poor country. Great tyranny. Lay down thy basest shirt. For goodness dare not check thee. Where thou thy wrongs? The title is a fear. Fare thee well, my lord. I would not be the villain that thou thinkst for the whole space that's in the tyrant's grasp, and the riches to boot.
Be not offended, I speak not in absolute fear of you. I think our country sinks beneath the yoke. It weeps, it bleeds, and with each new day a gash is added to her wounds. I think withal there will be hands uplifted in my right, an old steward with 10,000 warlike men was coming forth. But for all this, when I shall tread upon the tyrant's head, or wear it on my sword, yet my poor country shall suffer more vices than it had before, more suffer and more sundry than by him that shall succeed.
What should he be?
It is in myself I mean, in whom I know the particulars of vice so grafted that when opened, Black Macbeth will seem as pure as snow. The poor state will esteem him as a lamb compared with my confineless arms.
Not in the legions of horror. Become a devil more deadly than those to call Macbeth.
I've rent him bloody, luxurious, avaricious, false, deceitful, sudden, malicious smacking of every sin that has a name. Oh, with this there rose in my most ill-composed affection a stanchless avarice that, were I king, I would cut off your nobles for their lands. I would desire his jewels and this other's house, and my more having would act as a sauce that would make me hunger more, forging unjust quarrels against the good and loyal, destroying them for wealth.
This avarice sinks deep. It has been a sword of our slain kings.
Yet, do not fear.
Scotland hath foisions enough to fill up the will of your own. This is portable. Other graces waiting.
But I have none. The king becoming graces such as justice, verity, temperance, fortitude, mercy, lowliness, bounty, perseverance, patience, courage. I have none of them, but abound in the division of each several crime acting in many ways. Nay, had I power, I would pour the sweet milk of Concord into hell, disrupt the universal peace, confound all unity on earth.
Scotland! Scotland!
If one be fit to govern, speak, I am as I have spoken.
Fit to govern? No, not to live! Oh, nation miserable, with an untitled tyrant bloody scepter, when shalt thou see thy wholesome days again? Since at the truest issue of thy throne, by his own interdiction, stands a cursed, this blasphemous breed. Thy royal father was a most sainted king, and the queen that bore thee, oftener upon her knees than on her feet, died ever
day she lived. Fare thee well. These evils that repeatest upon thyself have banished me from Scotland. Oh, my brother, I hope thine's here. Macduff, this noble passion, child of integrity, hath from my soul wiped the black scruples and reconciled my thoughts with thy good truth and honor. Devilish Macbeth, by many of these strains, hath sought to win me into his power, and modest wisdom plucks me from over-incredulous haste. But God above deal between thee and me, for here I put myself unto thy direction, unspeak mine own detraction, and here abjure the taints and blames I laid upon myself. I am yet unknown to woman, never was forsworn, scarcely have coveted what was mine own. At no time broke my faith, would not betray the devil to his fellow, delight no less in truth than life. My first false speaking was this upon myself. What I am truly is thine and my poor country's to command. An old seaward with 10,000 warlike men, already at here point, was setting forth. Now let's together and let the chance of goodness be like our warranted quarrel. Why are you silent?
Such wild color, unwelcome things at once. It's hard to reconcile.
Well, war or not, come sneaking forth, I pray you.
Aye, sir. There are a crew of wretched souls that say his cure. The malady convinces the greatest day of art, but at his touch, such sanctity hath heaven given his hand, they presently amend.
I thank you, doctor.
What's the disease he means?
'Tis called the evil, a most miraculous working in this king. Often since my hearing in England I have seen him do.
See who comes here.
My countryman, yet I know him not.
Ever gentle cousin, welcome hither.
Good God, be kind, remove the means that make us strangers.
Sir, amen.
Send Scotland where it did.
Alas, poor country, almost afraid to know itself. It cannot be called our mother, but our grave, where nothing but who knows nothing is once seen to smile, where sighs and groans and shrieks that rent the air are made, not marked, where violent sorrow seems a modern ecstasy. The dead man's knell is there, scarce asked for who, and good men expire before the flowers in their caps, dying or ere they sicken.
Relation too nice,
not too true. What's the latest grief?
That of an hour's age doth hiss the speaker. Each minute teems a new one.
How does my wife?
Why, well.
And my children?
Well, too.
The times is not bad at their peace.
No, they were well at peace when I did leave them.
Be not a niggard if I speak, how goes it?
When I came hither to transport the tidings which I had heavily borne, there ran a rumor of many worthy fellows that were out, which was, to my belief, witnessed rather for that. I saw the tyrant's power afoot. Now is the time of help. Your eye in Scotland would create soldiers, make our women fight to doff their dire distresses.
Be their comfort, we are coming thither.
Would I answer this comfort with the like, but I have words which would be howled out in the desert air, where hearing should not latch them.
What concern that? The general cause, or is it a fevery? It is some single breast.
No mind but that's honest shares in it some woe. Oh, the main part pertains to you alone.
If it be mine, keep it not from me. Quickly let me have it.
Not your ears despise my tongue forever, for it shall burden them with the heaviest sound that ever yet they heard.
Yes, sir.
Your castle is surprised, your wife and babes savagely slaughtered. To relate the manner worked on the quarry of these murdered deer to add the death of you.
Merciful heaven! Hey, what? Man, ne'er pull your hat upon your brows, give sorrow words. And the grief that does not speak bids the orphan heart and bids it to break.
My children too.
I have said.
Oh. And I must flee from thence! My wife killed as well!
Wife, children, servants, all that could be found!
He has no children. All that friends. How can you say all? All! All my pretty
do so. I must also feel it as a man. Heaven look on and would not take their part. Oh, sin will make it die. They were struck by thee. No, not that I am, not for their own demerits, but for mine, fell slumber on their souls. Heaven rest it now.
Be this the whetstone to your sword. Convert grief to anger, blunt out the heart, and rage it.
Gentle heavens, cut short all intermission! Make the fiend bring down this fiend of Scotland to myself! Within my sword, let's set him! And if he escape, heaven forgive him too!
This tune goes up manly. Come, go we to the king! Our power is ready, our lack is nothing but our leave. Macbeth is ripe for shaking, and the powers above put on their instruments. Receive what cheer you may. The night is long, and it must never find the day.
I have watched with you two nights, quick kings, perceive no truth in your report. When was it she last walked?
Since his majesty went into the field, I have seen her rise from her bed, throw her nightgown upon her, unlock her closet, take forth paper, fold it, write upon it, read it, and afterwards seal it and again return to bed. Yet all this while in the most vast sleep.
A great perturbation in nature, to receive at once the benefits of sleep while doing the effects of watching. In this slumber agitation, besides her walking and her other matters, what, at any time, have you heard her say?
That, sir, which I will not report after her.
You may to me, and 'tis most meet you should.
Neither to you nor anyone, having no witness to confirm my speech. Lo you, here she comes. This is her very guise, and upon my life, fast asleep. Observe her. Stand close.
You see her eyes are open.
Aye, but their sins are shut.
What is it she does now? Look how she rubs her hands.
It is an accustomed action with her to seem thus washing her hands. I have known her to continue this in a quarter of an hour, and here's a spot!
Oh, she speaks.
Out! Damn spot! Out! I say, what? Do! Why then, 'tis time to do it. Oh, it's murky. Soldier and a fear? Who need fears who know it when none can call our power to account? Yet who would have thought the old man to have so much blood in him?
Do you want that?
Within a fife had a wife. Where is she now? Oh, what? Will these hands ne'er be clean? No more of that, my lord, no more of that. You mar all with this starting!
Go to, you know what you should not.
She has spoke what she should not, I am sure of that. Heaven knows what she has known. Here's the smell. Blood still. All the perfumes of Arabia will not sweeten this little hand.
What is time is there? The heart is sorely charged.
I would not have such a heart in my bosom for the dignity of the whole body.
Well.
May God it be, sir.
This disease is beyond my practice. Yet I've known those who have walked in their sleep to have died holily in their beds.
Wash your hands, put on your nightgown, look not so pale. I tell you. Yet again, Banquo is buried. He cannot come out on his brain.
Even so?
To bed! To bed! To bed! There's a knocking at the gate. Come, directly.
Foul whisperings are abroad. Unnatural deeds do bring unnatural troubles. Mourning she, the divine and the physician. God, help us all. Look after her. Remove from her the means of all annoyance and still keep eyes upon her. So good night. My mind she has made it and amazed my sight. I think, but dare not speak.
Good night, good doctor.
English power is near. But on my mouth I'm going to give it down. Revenge is burning in hell. For they have dear gods and voices that weigh in grim alarm, excite and mortify men.
Near Burnham one shall we meet them. That way are they headed.
Bring me no more reports!
Let them fly all. Till Burnham Wood removed to Dunsinane, I cannot take with thee. What's the boy matter? Was he not born of woman? The spirits that know all mortal consequence have pronounced of me thus. Fear not, Macbeth, for no man that's born of woman shall e'er have power upon thee. Then fly, false things, and mingle with the English epicure. The mind I sway by and the heart I bear shall never sag with doubt nor shake with fear. The devil's only black up green faced loom, where got thou a goose look?
There is 10,000 soldiers, sir!
Oh, prick thy face and over it, I fear thou lily Liverpool. What soldiers, Patch? Death of thy soul. Those living cheeks of thine are counselors to fear. What soldiers, brave face?
The English force, so please you.
Take thy face, hence. Satan! I'm sick at heart when I behold. Satan, I say! This push will cheer me ever, or deceit me now. I have lived long enough. My way of life is fallen into the sea, the yellow leaf. And that which should accompany old age, as honor, love, obedience, troops of friends, I must not look to have, but in their stead curses. Not loud, but deep. Mouth honor, breath which the poor heart would fain deny, and dare not.
Satan!
What's your gracious pleasure?
I'll fight till from my bones my flesh be hacked. Give me mine armor.
Tis not needed yet.
I'll put it on! Send out war horses, skirt the country round, hang those that talk of fear. Give me mine armor.
How does your patient, doctor?
Not so sick, my lord, as she is troubled with thick coming fancies. Keep her from her rest.
Canst thou not minister to a mind diseased? Pluck from the memory a rooted sorrow? Raise out the written troubles of the brain, and with some sweet, oblivious antidote, cleanse the stuffed bosom of that which weighs upon the heart?
Patient must minister to himself.
Throw physic to the dogs! Oh, none of it. Come, put my arm round.
If thou canst, doctor, cast the waters of my land, find her disease, and purge it to a sound and pristine health, I will applaud thee to the very echo that should applaud again.
What a rhubarb. Senna, or what purgative drug would scour these English hence? I will not be afraid of death and bane till Burnham Forest come to Dunsany.
outward walls. The cry is still they come. Our castle's strength will laugh a siege to scorn. Here let them lie till famine and the ague eat them up.
What is that noise?
It's the cry of women, my good lord.
I have almost forgot the taste of fear. The time had been my senses would have cooled to hear a night shriek, and my fell of hair would have the dismal trees roused and stirred as life were in it. I have supped full with horrors. Direness, familiar to my slaughterous thoughts, cannot once start me. Therefore was that cry.
The queen, my lord, is dead.
She should have died hereafter. There would have been a time for such a word. Tomorrow, and tomorrow, and tomorrow creeps in this pet and pace from day to day to the last syllable of recorded time, and all our yesterdays have lighted fools the way to dusty death. Out, out, brief candle, life's but a walking shadow, a poor player who struts and frets his hour upon the stage and then is heard no more. It is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing. Thou comest to use thy tongue for thy story quickly.
Gracious my lord, I should report that which I say is all, but no, not how to do it.
Well, say, sir.
As I did stand my watch upon the hill, I looked toward Gornham and anon me thought, the wood began to move,
liar and slave!
Through your half of it, not be so. Within this 3 mile may you see it coming, I say, a moving robe.
If thou speakest false, upon the next tree shall thou hang alive till famine cling thee. If thy speech be sooth, I care not if thou dost for me as much. I pull in resolution and begin to doubt the equivocation of a fiend. And lies like the truth. Fear not till burning forest come to Dunsinane, and how a wood is come toward Dunsinane. Arm and arm out. This which he avouches does appear, there is nor flying hence nor tarrying here. I begin to grow a weary of the sun, and wish the estate of the world were now undone. Blow, wind, come. Rack! At least the wheel died with harness on our back.
You have already uncle! That was my right noble cousin! We have our first battle! A doctor we will take upon what our commands to do!
Very well!
What am I to fear, or none?
What is thy name?
Thou'll be afraid to hear it.
No, thou callst thyself a hotter name than any is in hell.
My name's Macbeth.
The devil himself could not pronounce a title more hateful to mine ear.
Oh, nor more fearful.
Thou liest, abhorred villain, with my sword I'll prove the letter.
Thou wast born of a woman.
This way, the noise is! Target!
Show thy face! Thou beast slain, and with no stroke of mine, my wife and children's ghosts will haunt me still. Nay, I cannot strike at wretched kerns, whose arms are hired to bear their staves. Either thou, Macbeth, or my sword again, with an unbattered edge, I shall sheath undeated. Where thou shouldst be, may this great note, one of
One of Grant's note seems rooted. Let me find you, Fortune. And more I ask not!
Why should I play the Roman fool and die on my own sword? Whilst I see lives, the gashes do better upon them.
Turn, hellhound,
turn!
Of all men else I have avoided thee, but get thee back. My soul is too much charged with blood of thine already.
I have no words. My voice is in my sword. The bloodier fill the Turks can give thee out.
Thou losest labor. Easier thou be a trenchant heir with thy keen sword and platinum presses make me bleed. But fall thy blade on vulnerable press, I bear a charmed life, which must not yield to one of
despair thy charm! Let that angel of still hath served tell thee my darkness from his mother's womb untimely rest!
Accursed be the tongue that tells me so! For have cowed my better part of man. And be these juggling fiends no more believed than palter with us in a double sense, keeping the word of promise to our ear and breaking it to our hope. I'll not fight with thee.
And yield thee, coward! Live to be a gaze and show of the time. You have you, as our rarer monsters are, painted upon a pole. And under it, here may you see the tyrant.
I will not yield to kiss the ground before young Malcolm speaks and be baited by the rabble's curse. Though Burnham would become to Dunsinane an outpost, being of no woman born, yet I will try the last. Before my body I do throw my warlike shield. Lay on Macduff, and damn be him that first cries, hold, enough!
Hail, King of Scotland!